Easy.
Welcome to Skyline College, where we have a big one in USL League 2 action in the Southwest Division. Two top sides facing each other, with the San Francisco Glens hosting the Oakland Roots. I'm Geoffrey Ulysses Geissinger, and joining me on the call is Kylen Mills. Kylen, what can we expect from the Glens side in this one?
This is going to be an incredibly competitive match, Geoffrey, which is exactly what we saw the last time these two teams met on May 29th. The Glens able to get on the board first, a 1-0 win thanks to Max Kretien knocking one in the back of the net on the 32nd minute. They were able to hold on. I expect this match to be very competitive. Head coach Gabe Sosedo said this Project 510 side, very technical, very organized, and very well coached. The Glens will be looking to build out of the back, build their attack through possession, and Sosedo said he wants them just to stay organized and communicate, especially based on just how dangerous some of these Project 510 forwards are.
And on the other side, one of those players maybe is Etzker Cruz. The 15-year-old made his debut against San Francisco City in their last match on Thursday, and it got a late goal in that one. He might be a spark plug on the Roots, Oakland Roots Project 510 side. You also have mentioned Diego Grande, five goals. Is there anything that Sosedo had to say about him?
Sosedo mentioned two of the spark plugs for this offense, Max Kretien and Diego Grande. Both have a nose for the goal and are very strong on the ball. However, the Glens have to hold on to this top spot in the league that they're sitting in right now. Sosedo said he does not want them to let up. He wants them to play like they're chasing the top spot.
5-1-0 nipping at their heels, 1 point behind. The Glens road trip, four games unbeaten. Were there any standout moments on that trip for you?
To me, Geoffrey, the Glens just want to continue to ride the momentum from the massive 4-1 win they earned in their last game against Ventura County. They want to try to keep that going and bring that same confidence into today's match right from kickoff.
When we come back, starting lineups, and we'll see how this one plays out.
We created Carlsberg 0-0 because even the best things can be better. Where our golf we've been.
A clean one-handed backhand is better. Balancing stuff is better. Whatever this is better.
We created
Carlsberg.
Skipping your own ad is better.
Parking in space. Better.
So, can the best our golf we've been make good things better? Probably.
Welcome back to USL League 2 action here at Skyline College with the San Francisco Glens against Oakland Roots Project 510. We're going to bring you the starting lineups now. First up, the Oakland Roots Project 510 lineup for the visitors. Few standouts on that lineup, including Timothy Cyrell, who made an appearance earlier this season, subbing off the bench against Los Dos to keep a clean sheet for the Roots in that championship match. Another player to look for, Nicholas Dossmann, spent time with the Mainz U19s in Germany. Now for the Glens starting lineup.
lots of continuity in Gabe Saucedo's lineups. Kylen, is there anyone in particular that you think might be a player to watch in this one?
A player to watch for me is Nathan Simeon playing at outside back. He returns to the Glens for the first time since May 21st. He had to go back to Canada to deal with a visa issue. He is an international player at the University of San Francisco, an incredibly skilled outside back and just so quick on the ball. He can get into the attack and be very, very dangerous when he does get forward.
His return also reunites that USF Dons back line, each member a player for University of San Francisco, as well as Kevin Lowe in midfield, as we are about to get underway on a windy San Bruno day, as it always is.
Expect this to be a very competitive match. These two teams at the top of the conference in USL 2 league play. And Project 510 is coming off a big win over SF City.
The regional rivalries, four Bay Area teams all vying for supremacy in the Southwest Division. Both the Glens and 510 have defeated City in each of their matchups against each other, as that ball will immediately be fired long, and you can see the wind already floating it up. Dossman with a big header down.
Another player to watch for me is Andy Velásquez, inserted into the central midfield position. Head coach Gabe Saucedo said he did excellent the last time these two teams met just a few weeks ago. Velásquez, with a very successful career at UC Davis, an all Big West second team selection, had 4 goals and 2 assists for the Aggies this season.
That ball will be slid inside to Luis Saldana. His ball out wide, trying to find Carlos Cruz. Simeon, though.
There you saw Simeon's speed. It's going to be very difficult for any forward to get by him. He is so quick.
5-1-0 coming with a big press, winning that Dutour clearance. Dutour will step to the top of his box to claim that one. Valdivia opening it up a little bit with a bit of pace. And Lowe will find Grande out wide. That ball, though, will be cut out. And 5-1-0 will look to recycle it with a bit of press there from Velásquez.
Diego Grande, a player who has been identified by Coach Saucedo as a spark plug for this Glens offense. He says he has a nose for the goal. And here he might have an opportunity.
He will try and find Chrétien, but it will be snuffed out. And a true kind of story of everything that the Glens want to be. An academy player signed at 16 in 2019, now playing at Dominican, and now rejoining the first team here in this 2022 season and finding lots of success.
The Glens have done an excellent job of creating that pipeline to the pros that you hear leaders of the club talk about. You can start with the Glens at a young age, all different levels of club teams going all the way up, and now they're part of the MLS Next program. And then with this USL 2 team, this really gives college players the opportunity to be seen by professional scouts and to play at that next level.
A lovely bit of combination. That ball will fall for Kevin Lowe, and his shot will be wide off the volley, but he will be fouled, and so it'll be a free kick in a dangerous position here for the Glens.
Kevin Lowe does such a good job of just mixing it up and getting on the end of those 50-50 balls at the middle of the field. He's not tall in stature, but he plays so big, so aggressive on 50-50s, able there to draw the foul in a very dangerous position for the Glens.
Will he stand over it? You might see Valdivia, who's offered service. Mahi has had some long-range efforts, particularly a long-range goal against UC Davis. Glens were down 2-0 in that one, dragged their way back as his screamer stole points.
Saucedo said it's so important for the Glens to come out aggressive right from tip-off. This would be huge if they can put one in the back of the net.
Mahi runs over it. His effort under the wall and wide. Looks like it was deflected. At least it's deemed that way by center referee Brian Cordova Munoz. And Valdivia will head out and take a corner. Another set piece opportunity.
Interesting there. It looks like the Glens may be trying to confuse their opponents. I wasn't sure who was going to take it until Mahi stepped up for the strike with the left foot.
Miss ball from Valdivia, curling, headed away strongly by Dossman. Carranza will reserve it. Chrétien trying to keep it in. We'll just flick it out, allowing the rest of the big bodies that gotten forward to reset, regain their position.
This Project 510 team, well-coached, well-organized, technical. They're not going to be easy to beat out the back.
Their head coach, Michael Hannon, a Swansea, Wales native, spent time in the Swansea Academy and also part of St. Mary's, that 2019 run where they went undefeated, won a WCC title, and lost on penalties in the NCAA tournament to eventual champion Stanford. But that's a bad giveaway as Saldana. They're pressing high, and Bakuzi will able to win it back.
And all season, goalkeeper Hugo Dutour has struggled with the ball at his feet. Sometimes he wants to play with it. He sits on it too much, and he's put himself in dangerous positions with forwards crashing the net, applying pressure like we just saw here. That could have been a goal.
Another chance here as Bakuzi will try and fend off 510, who have been pressing relentlessly. And it will be out for another throw-in on that far side. Lorenzo Hernandez with it in his hands.
Especially when you're playing a team with three up top, you have to really be careful when you get the ball at your feet in that goalkeeper position, because when you've got three very fast players running at you, you've got to make decisions quickly.
Hernandez does well. He'll receive it again. And they'll just keep it here. Redfield to Dossman. Slid inside to Saldana. And Mahi unable to win it, a sliding challenge. And Bakuzi will fire it forward again. Not a whole lot of possession in the Glens for this one. What might they look to do to try and connect some of these pieces that seem to be disjointed?
Well, right now it starts with being organized defensively, which they've done a good job of so far. Project 510 not getting any real clear chances. Then it comes to building the ball at the back and getting that entry pass from the middle third to the offensive third. That's where the ball is being taken away right now. We've seen a couple that the forwards just can't control, or the execution on the pass is just a little bit off.
Grande there battling with Pablo Ramirez Belmont, playing at Holy Names. Just finished his junior season where he was the team MVP. Slotting in at left back for 510. That outside of the boot effort will be deflected.
You can hear Kevin Lowe yelling at the back line and some of his Glens teammates to get organized. He has been a vocal leader for this team all season with the captain's band on. Lowe joins the Glens with a lot of experience at USF. Played and started in every game this past season.
Also a member of the Timbers Academy. Been talking to Gabe Saucedo pregame. He's carrying a bit of a knock to his knee, so they might try and look to limit his minutes here as he's played every single minute so far in this Glen season. Simeon will take that bump, and it will be deflected out for a deemed a 5-1-0 throw-in down there in the corner. But you'll see Simeon likes to maraud forward, find himself in attacking positions, and he fancies his right foot as well to have a strike.
The Glens play with a 4-3-3 with three central midfielders. They don't play with a traditional outside mid. That's where the opportunity comes up for an outside back like Nathan Simeon to get forward, get into the attack, look to make an overlapping run outside of the wing up top. And Simeon has the speed to do it and to be dangerous on the ball.
Maybe Valdivia heard us talking about Simeon's attacking chops and he decided to have his own run forward there. and it will be out for a throw-in that he will take quickly to Jonathan Estrada. Estrada's ball headed away by Redfield.
Keep the ball!
And Bracken Serra, the leading goal scorer for 5-1-0 on it. Find Edgar Cruz, the young goal scorer from their win against City on Thursday, that 3-1 victory.
The Glens did a good job right there of getting numbers behind the ball, getting back, and now forcing Project 5-1-0 to play out the back in their own defensive third.
Suleiman Karami out wide to Lorenzo Hernandez. That ball will be slid through. Dangerous opportunity. A spall serviced in, but Velasquez equal to it. Controlled, Karami. Nice bit of skill, but a dive deemed by center referee Brian Cordova-Munoz.
Hard to see from our angle. It looked like Kevin Lowe may have caught a leg there, which to me is a foul.
Juan O'Neill out wide to Hernandez. The 5-1-0 enjoying the lion's share of possession early on, and that's a dangerous ball. Carlos Cruz behind Charalaghi. He's battling. He gets on the other side, and that ball across will be not too dangerous. Dutour waves his hand saying, I got it. No worries.
The Glens back line, Bakuzi, Charalaghi at center back especially, have to be careful not to let anything go over the top. You've got to drop back, keep the ball in front of you, and clear that away out of the air. Otherwise, once you're turning and you're running at your own goal, it's a foot race between you and the striker.
And they'll have to deal with more of those balls in this half with the wind blowing in their faces and at the back of 5-1-0.
Yes, the wind absolutely a factor here at Skyline College. Geoffrey, we were just joking. Is it ever not windy out here at Skyline College in San Bruno?
Not from what I can tell.
Based on our personal experiences, no.
It's anecdotal. It's not scientific, but 3 out of 3 is a pretty good indication. That's a giveaway from Charalaghi. Saldana trying to make an effort on goal, but Dutour will just trap it with his left foot. That sauce that he loves to display, his cheekiness, egging Saldana on.
Sometimes Dutour just needs to play the simple ball, scoop it up in your hands, and get it off quickly. There are opportunities to counterattack off the goalkeeper if you can get a quick throw, a quick punt. He just likes to sit with it, to draw on a defender, or draw forward, rather, to him. I'd like to see him change it up more. Sometimes just scoop it up and get a quick redistribution.
That ball will be fired away by Belmont, Ramirez Belmont. And nearly won by Karami on the far side. Another ball forward, not too dangerous for Dossman. An easy touchdown. Makes it look so simple.
That's a bad giveaway out the back for the Glens. They've got to keep possession and play to feet, especially playing into the wind where the ball is going to die. If you're looking to go over the top, it's going to be very difficult for the Glens.
Juan O'Neill unlocks Karami. Cruz with a touch, but some eager goalkeeping from Dutour. Quick off his line, puts out the fire.
Here's where the Glens need to build possession, but find a way to get that entry pass into the attacking third. They do a good job of swinging it around the back. But like with that ball right there, they're struggling to find the feet of one of their forwards, even midfielders.
A flick on, but Redfield steps up easily and wins it. 5-1-0 have been a very strong team in the first half. Their game at home against the Seahorses scored 2 goals very early on in that one to really put the Seahorses on the back foot. And so far, they've done a good job of forcing the Glens into mental mistakes, maybe if you'd want to call them that, and poor giveaways.
Project 5-1-0 is doing a good job of just applying pressure up top and making it difficult for the Glens defenders to swing that ball around the back, forcing them to make decisions quickly. And if you're not ready and on your toes, you could get caught. And Project 5-1-0 suddenly wins the ball and they're looking to go to goal.
We'll have a chance off the set piece here. Dossman, a threat to watch out for. Two goals this year, including a big header. He'll be lined up with Jack Bacuzzi.
Looks like this will be an in-swinger with a left foot.
That ball in, Dutour able to claim it. They're claiming that he maybe got pushed in, and they're saying a goal. No, a free kick, rather. Or they're saying...
Let's take another look at that. The in-swinger.
Redfield pushed him in. And from that replay, it looks like a goal. Dutour backpedals into the goal, pressured by Josh Redfield, the Oakland native.
That's exactly why you want to have a forward standing right on the goalkeeper. Anytime you have a set play or a corner kick, a lot of teams will employ that tactic. You have one player right in front of the goalie.
And a great eye from second official on that far side, the second AR, Ian Sullivan.
As soon as it happened, it looked to me like he had stepped into the net. Can't quite tell from our position at half field, or midfield, rather. Once you saw it on the replay, it was clear as day. He was into the net with that ball. And that's why that left-footed in-swinger can be so dangerous. Even if it doesn't find the head of a teammate, it can curl its way into the net or create a very difficult situation for the keeper.
Does that count as an Olympico, you know? If the goalkeeper catches it and waddles into the goal, does that count as an Olympico?
That's a great question, Geoffrey.
Another mental mistake, though, that it happened against Marin. First 30 seconds, a mental mistake, penalty conceded, and the Glens find themselves again in their third home game of the season behind early on. We'd also like to thank Condor Soccer. Get the new Streets of San Francisco 2022 USL League 2 collection exclusively at San Francisco Glens home games. Next one is Sunday, June 26th at 1 p.m. for SoCal Seahorses right here at Skyline. Today's
game is streaming live on... Right now, the Glens need to start connecting passes and try to get a rhythm going offensively. They have not been able to possess the ball at all so far. Some credit has to go to the Project 510 forwards, who are applying a lot of pressure and making it difficult for the Glens to build that attack out of the back. However, composure going to be key. And then looking to find that entry pass into the middle and attacking third. Find someone's feet. And stay patient.
Step up, Tito. Now you step.
It's also not an entirely unfamiliar position for the Glens. This, again, like I said earlier, they did come back against Davis. So they've done it before. One goal isn't that much, especially with 75 minutes left.
That last possession, Geoffrey, another example. Shayan Charalaghi gets the ball and back. He doesn't have anyone. Really, truly is an easy option. He sees two forwards running at him, and he's forced to just boot it downfield. It ends up being a giveaway.
Handball there from Kretzian. We'll give the ball to 5-1-L. Bit of energized pressing from Grande, and Simeon will win that header. Kretzian will try and flick it down for his teammates, but no one's there. Cruz with a chest. Saldana, a little flick. Lovely combination here from 5-1-0. Cheekily bopping it around. But the Glens will be able to come the other way. Until Lorenzo Hernandez says otherwise. Valdivia, he'll make a run forward here. Finds the feet of Kretien, who will lay it off, but it's a little bit behind Valdivia. And now Saldana will make a run. He'll be bumped by Charalaghi. Referee says up, nothing in that.
All right, we haven't got it, Luis. Get on now.
And Dutour will play Charalaghi.
There's that cop sideways on. Sideways on.
That long ball fired to Valdivia, chested down well. 1-2 with Estrada.
Take your shoulder.
Simeon on the right wing. Plays down the line for Grande. Grande won't be able to win it as Ramirez Belmont is able to physically shoulder him off of it. Kevin Lowe, a big tackle from Edsker Cruz, and another sliding challenge then from Valdivia.
The Glens are doing a great job of mixing it up in the middle, challenging every ball out of the air, aggressively attacking 50-50 balls. Their problem and struggle right now is trying to get into the attack and really connect a string of passes.
5-1-0 still pressing, but a little lighter. And Charalaghi will clip that for Grande. Maybe off of his back, but he still is going forward. Chrétien. Simeon will take a touch, and he'll fly by Ramirez Belmont. And that will be a foul and a yellow card for Ramirez Belmont. We'll take another quick look at the challenge.
Yeah, he didn't get anywhere near a piece of the ball on that foul. I think it's a fair yellow card with Simeon potentially able to create a goal-scoring opportunity on a cross had he gotten through.
A tactical foul. Definition of a yellow.
Yellow card. Project 510. Pablo Ramirez.
Hey, let's go, focus.
Valdivia will wait for Cordova Munoz to finish writing in his book. Get ready to offer some service. Hopefully it's service worth tipping for.
He has that left foot, so we could also see another in-swinger here. Valdivia, the left-footed player, typically
a little bit off the line if he wanted to angle it towards goal.
PK spot!
To the left! Yep, right there! Behind you, good.
What's that?
A delay here. Bit of physicality in the box. We'll try and sort that out.
It's all about fighting for position in the box.
And that will go to the back post, headed in and bouncing around, and a counter opportunity. And that ball will be flicked on Edgar Cruz. But Kevin Lowe will take the bump and at least make sure that they don't have to worry about any counterattack, lethally punishing them with numbers forward.
Smart play and nicely done by Kevin Lowe just to get a quick touch, get that ball out of bounds, and give your teammates time to get back, get behind the ball, and reset on the throw-in. Edsker Cruz is so dangerous. You saw his speed right there. He was flying at Kevin Lowe. He made his debut for Project 5110 last week, scored a goal, and you can see why.
Nice combination through the midfield, and Chrétien will fire it in. Back post in Velásquez. A sliding effort, collapsing onto his back. Knows that that was a golden opportunity. And it will be a goal kick here for 5-1-0.
Coach Sacedo said the Glens really have worked on trying to utilize the flank, get the ball wide, and then swing it in and crash the goal on crosses. We've seen them find success in previous games that we've called here at Skyline College and throughout the season. Scoring off the cross, scoring off a bounce, off a volley. A great opportunity there for Velásquez. However, those are difficult balls to get on the end of.
Pablo Ramirez Belmont here down as the Oakland Roots Project 510 trainer will attend to him. Diego Grande will come to the near side, get some words of advice from Robbie Ricks, goalkeeper coach who grew up with the Arsenal Academy, or sorry, just assistant coach who grew up with the Arsenal Academy. His first year on the staff. No Jimmy Conrad on the sideline today. So Rick's filling in.
Yeah, noticeable absence of technical director Jimmy Conrad. What a huge name to be with the SF Glens now. He just brings such a wealth of soccer experience, having played at the highest level.
Both sides will kind of use this as a timeout with full sides coming to the touchline to get words of instruction, as it looks like it will be a substitution made. Pablo Ramirez Belmont's day is done. He will pick up that yellow. Curious when that knock happens, unsure, but in his place will be Javier Ruiz Duran.
Take a look at the guy.
Whenever there is an injury like this, you've got to use the opportunity as a player to take a drink of water, take your break while you can. That's why you see both teams here on the sideline getting instruction from their coaches, also trying to get a quick swig. As we're about halfway through the first half here at Skyline College. Head coach Gabe Sosedo giving his men some instruction right now as they take a drink of water. Really a windy day out here at Skyline College, 24 miles per hour. That absolutely plays a factor in the game. When you look at balls in the air, if you're going into the wind, it's going to just stop.
You can see even just on the jerseys of the players standing there, whipping against their body. And the substitution will be official. Javier Ruiz Duran will take his place. Almost surprising that Ruiz Duran did not start this match with his experience. A Santa Clara man, born in Barcelona, Spain. He has played 75 games for the Santa Clara Broncos, three-time All-West Coast first team All-West Coast Conference, as well as this past season being a coach's All-West Region selection. Played the 10 at Santa Clara, but the coaching staff for the Oakland Roots project him as more of a left back at the next level, and so he will slot back in that position today, taking the place of Pablo Ramirez Belmont. Charalaghi will maybe try and test him early with that ball forward, but Dossman will collect easily.
That's another giveaway for the Glens. They have to try to keep the ball, do a better job of finding feet. However, it looks like at times the outside and center backs for the Glens are on an island. They're looking forward. They don't see anyone. There seems to be a disconnect between the forwards, the midfield, and defenders for the Glens.
And Ruiz Duran will press high. And he'll poke it out. Simeon won't be able to take the throw. Kevin Lowe trying to squeeze one into Grande. Sorted out, though. The Glens will be able to keep it. Nice turn inside from Kevin Lowe. Had three guys around him and was able to evade the pressure. Valdivia firing that in. Grande will try and make a play for it. Can he keep it in? He can. Against the newly subbed on Ruiz Duran. But Carlos Cruz will come in and help. Dragged down, but no call. Simeon on the inside. Flicked in. Estrada's effort saved by Cyrell.
Great effort by the Glens, and it all started with Diego Grande battling for the ball, able to keep it in bounds, continuing to fight despite having two defenders crashing on him hard. Nathan Simeon comes up with the ball and is able to put it in a dangerous position.
Cyro with a big, big save on that Estrada chance.
Lorenzo, decisive!
But that's just proof that every ball matters, even if it seems like you might not be able to get to it. Anything might come.
Incredible hustle and physicality by Diego Grande.
Nully, stay connected!
Leading up to that goal-scoring opportunity for the Glens.
Estrada played to Velasquez, but Velasquez didn't check his shoulder. Got a man coming. The Glens will try and play out of the back.
There has to be more movement off the ball. When Hugo Dutour, the Glens goalkeeper, had that ball played back to him, I looked around. There wasn't anybody moving. The Glens two center backs were looking to receive the ball back, but no one else was moving.
Seems as though that's been a common thread through our games. Is that there's been a lack of connection, connective tissue for each side, or for the Glens. But an opportunity here is Chrétien will play Mahi. Mahi's speed tries to turn and burn, and it will be poked out for a corner. Another set piece opportunity.
Lock up!
And against Marin,
corner
in their last home game, although it wasn't directly off a set piece, it was a recycled set piece, and then a ball served in from a set piece-like area from Eric Pierce. That's where their goal came from.
Glenn's looking to put a lot of numbers into the box. Center backs Bakusi and Charalaghi getting in on it.
This effort from Mahi, floating and floating, and Cyrell with an easy jump and a catch.
When looking to play that ball across on the corner, you want more of a driven ball. When it lofts up in the air like that, it gives the defenders and goalkeeper more time to get underneath it and get a better position on it. A driven ball is much more difficult to handle.
Velasquez flicking it on, Mahi racing and sprinting, but Hernandez will chest it down, and they'll try and play out of the back. Big numbers here forward for the Glens, but Cruz, a great poke, and Saldana's in. He'll have Charalaghi chasing him. He'll slow down enough, and Charalaghi will make the block. Maybe a bit more directness there from Saldana would be desired from the 5-1-0 coaching staff.
Charalaghi did a good job of getting back and just playing smart 1v1 defending, getting low, getting in your defensive stance. However, that could have ended a totally different way. The Glens have to be careful to keep their shape defensively and be ready for a counterattack.
And now might they be able to spring one the other way? Velasquez trying to find Mahi, but maybe a bit of miscommunication. Mahi's run took him outside. The ball went inside, but a win high for Granze. He will try and make an effort at the byline and is crossed in, but Cyrell will claim it. We'd also like to thank one of our other sponsors, Churros El Güero. Churros are our family's tradition, and we can stuff them with four different fillings and pair yours with delicious soft serve ice cream. Call us to come to your next corporate event or wedding. After all, the only thing sweeter than our churros is true love.
And a Glens win.
And that is definitely true.
Hey, Javi, just get us moving the ball and calm it down a bit, okay? Get us moving the ball. Calm it down.
Although I'm curious about the four different fillings and in each of the pairings. Like, is there like a ranking, a hierarchy?
A hierarchy of churro fillings?
Yes. Like a power rankings, you know?
I think we're going to have to investigate, Geoffrey, next game. Bring the churros out here to Skyline College.
Taste test.
That's the only way.
The battle in midfield here will be a foul call. On one or four in favor of Juan O'Neill. As we inch closer to the 32nd mark here in San Bruno.
So far in the half, the Glens have done a pretty good job staying organized, communicating on defense. Project 510 has not had a lot of real clear-cut chances. They're able to score on that corner. But the Glens have had the better run of play here as the half has gone on.
A slip there from Cruz, and Grande was trying to play it through to Estrada. He was making that sprinting run. That's a thundering defensive header from Valdivia. Trying to play a bit of soft tiki-taka centrally, but it doesn't come off, and Cruz will be in a foot race with Simeon. Simeon trying to poke it away, and a sliding challenge does just that. Corner.
The Glens back line has to be careful about those streaking runs forward when Project 510 is looking to thread the needle between two Glens defenders. You made that run just between Nathan Simeon and center back Shayan Charalaghi. Simeon did track him, but Cruz had a foot up on him. He was a step ahead when that ball was played. Simeon able to catch up based on his speed, though.
Reese Duran's ball curling in, a different taker this time of this corner, as Estrada's header will clear the danger. Hey, He'll now switch back over to his left side at his position and take the throw. Cruz, nifty turn, and his ball served in. That tests Dutour, but not too badly. Not as difficult as an SAT or an ACT, but maybe a standardized test.
Those standardized tests were just the worst. The worst.
There's three C's in a row, and you're like, it can't be another C. There's no way.
Wind really picking up here as Dutour prepares to take the goal kick.
Juan O'Neill will win that header. Velasquez will try and boot it forward. And it will just bounce around as Mahi tries to keep it in. But his touch will just be a little wayward. Hernandez will take this throw. A first-team signee as well, and has spent time with the El Salvador U-20 team and is committed to San Diego State. He's going to be an Aztec next season.
Drop down, Javi. Drop down. Drop down.
There you go. Dossman to Redfield. Bracken Serra. Elongated spell of possession. And the Glens will press more numbers as Charalaghi wins that out, but O'Neill almost able to find an opening, but instead it will go the other way. Cruz, a flying challenge, and Simeon will be taken down by Bracken Serra. Calls from the Glens bench for a foul. Not heeded.
If anything, that first slide was more dangerous. He didn't catch Simeon's foot, but he came in, guns a-blazing, and easily could have.
Cruz, on that right foot that he used before, will curl this one as well. But a goal kick, that is all that's deemed of it. The next match here on KRONon will be Sunday, June 10th against Centro Valley Fuego 2.
July 10th?
July 10th.
Unless we're going back in time, I was like, I'm pretty sure it's July.
The churros have magical powers, and the fillings will actually take you back in time. It's so sweet. July 10th at 1 p.m. That Fuego team has struggled with five losses in seven matches so far this season.
With about 8.5 to go in this first half, the Glens want to try to get on the board and tie this game up. It's unfortunate. Both their last two today and their last home game here at Skyline College, they've been chasing in the first half.
A ball slipped through. Saldana, though, offside, according to Ian Sullivan.
That absolutely looked offside. Offsides. Nice job by the Glens back line on holding their line and staying organized, communicating.
But you've seen that's where Saldana likes to operate, trying to slip his runs in between the two center backs and find those through balls or balls played over the top.
Those are difficult runs to handle for a defender. You have to constantly be communicating about who's picking up that player that's streaking forward.
Luis Duran sprints in front, and Cruz will play him in. He'll have a chance to serve this one. Saldana will let it go. Passed on. Karami on the back post, his right-footed effort into the belly of Hugo Dutour.
Great save by Hugo Dutour.
Glens will try and play around and finds a pass forward. Bakuzi finds Kretien, the man at the top, but he will give the ball away to Josh Redfield before winning it right back. Juan O'Neill will hand this off to Lorenzo Hernandez. neither player able to win the header there. Valdivia nor Saldana, and it'll be a goal kick again. Now we've talked about familiarity in some of these other games, familiarities between players within teams and players on opposing teams, with Marin, with Diego Grande, a Dominican player, and Dominican players on the other side. Well, in this one, you have a similar deal as well, with multiple Santa Clara players, including Javier Ruiz Duran, and a Santa Clara player on the Glens bench, Josh DeBora, who will likely factor into this one at a later stage. Juan O'Neill also, a 20 graduate, class of 20, born in Puerto Rico. Kretien, though. Ball roll to Lowe. A ball roll on his end. And Bracken Serra steps and wins it well. Before Lowe will win it back, and they'll play on. Ruiz Duran trying to get in front of Simeon, and Simeon willing his way in front. Maybe a bit of a hold, but nothing called by the referee. And that ball will just pop up and it'll stay in. No pressure from the Glens.
Looked like there could have been a whistle there in favor of the Glens as Nathan Simeon went down.
His ball served in off Juan O'Neill. Tyrell with a little volleyball volley into himself, and they'll say it'll actually be out. It'll be a corner.
Oh, wow.
Didn't get to it quick enough.
With 5 minutes to go in this first half, this is a huge opportunity for the Glens to crash the net.
Punched away by Cyrell. Karami heads it further.
Ref, head! Ref!
And Valdivia. Oh, but well won back by Karami. But it looks like there's an injury down in the box, a head injury to one of the 5-1-0 men. So we'll get it right this time. July 10th. July 10th against Centro Valley Fuego 2. 1 p.m. here at Skyline College and on KRONon. You can catch the game live or online. We'd love to have you with us.
The Glens looking to protect that top spot in the Southwest Division in USL 2 league play. The Glens 4-1-1 on the season. Central Valley Fuego FC struggling early on at 1-5-1. Today, though, the top spot on the line.
5-1-0 win this, they leapfrog the Glens into that first slot. Although technically, they are tied with SoCal Seahorses, but sit behind them on the first tiebreaker, which is head-to-head competition. That's another thing that makes this game so important. Even a draw for the Glens puts them over the head-to-head tiebreaker. Saldana to Karami. He'll try and flick it by, but it'll be cleared by Bakuzi, a jumping karate kick. We'll volley it away. That awkward bounce in the air. It'll be a throw for 5-1-0.
The 2022 official Streets of San Francisco collection by Condor Soccer is available exclusively at our pop-up team store next to the ticket booth.
Chested and flicked on by Saldana. And Valdivia was sliding. A lot of players having success going to the ground to win balls today. Zestrada will be held. Little jersey pull on the turn. They'll have a free kick. Nice combination play. And they'll try and find Mahi, who's sprinting. That speed. Foul call there. Lorenzo Hernandez feels otherwise. It will be a booking as well for Hernandez.
Come on, man.
Hernandez also spent time, his academy time, his club career, the Deonza Force.
Yellow card could have been issued because it looked like Junior Mahi may have had a chance on goal had he been able to streak through and turn the jets on with that speed that he has. If it looks like a chance or an opportunity on goal, then there's got to be a card, unless they were calling it because maybe the slide was from behind.
Valdivia and Lowe will be over this one.
Project 510 coaching staff not happy with that call.
Pleading their case to fourth official Christian Sapien.
Come on, see it up!
No.
Luis, Mark!
Ball served in Valdivia, headed away though by Dossman. An opportunity if 510 can counter Cruz. Nobody at the halfway line, even just a flick on.
Hey, what is he doing?
What, hey?
What is he doing?
But a call there. And another set piece position.
Look at the size of them. They're about 7 foot two. And they can't take a hour in the back.
Foul call there.
The official indicates there was a push, arm out, push on the back. Project 510 coaching staff arguing that.
It's maybe a bit of deliberation. Could there be a bit of set piece theater? A play straight from the training grounds? Last time it was in a position like this, Mahi tried to slide it under the wall and it was deflected out for a corner.
From this position, when you're so central, you want to take a strike on goal.
He will rip it. It'll be deflected. And Ruiz Duran prevents a corner.
They organize. Come on. See the hop out.
Goal here for the Glens would be huge, changing the halftime team talk. Mahi's effort curling, and it's off the bar.
A great opportunity by Mahi with an excellent strike with that left foot just off the crossbar and over. He did a good job to beat his defender, create some space, and rip one from not an easy angle.
A gentle kiss of the top side of the crossbar. You saw that left foot against Davis. Two goals this year. He was looking to add his third. As a bit of a trip there from Estrada.
Yellow.
And they'll play quickly, firing over the top. Karami, will he be able to keep it in play? He'll jog short of it, realize, nah. With the wind and the turf, too quick. About one more minute as we hit 46 on the clock.
This is dangerous right here.
Charalaghi, oh, Carranza slips. And 510 will get the ball for free. They'll play it back. And that's a dangerous little ball forward. Dossman will try and head it forward, but Velasquez can find Mahi, and Mahi's touch too strong, maybe off his shin guard. And a dangerous possible opportunity for the Glens goes missing. Hernandez will fling it, and Karami tries to pressure Bakuzi, and that ball will just pop straight up in the air. Miles high, but it will go out. It'll be a throw-in.
With just a couple seconds remaining, the Glens do not want to give up a goal here. They need to get it away from their defensive third.
Thrown forward. But the whistle will blow, the hand will go up, and that'll be halftime here at Skyline College with the Glens trailing Oakland Roots Project 510.
Project 510 won. And the SF Glens knew.
Both teams getting ready to make their way to the locker room.
Can we please bring your attention to the field?
As on the field at halftime, there will be kids playing, but again, halftime score. Halftime score here at Skyline College in San Bruno. Oakland Roots Project 510-1, San Francisco Glens 0.
You look good, you feel good, so we got you some nice stuff. Check it out.
missing pauses.
You mean passes?
No, pauses. The secret to winning is to pause.
I'm taking a step back.
What's the reason?
Sometimes you gotta stop to be, you know, an actual human.
Take a minute to celebrate, right?
Or 20.
Pause is power.
Welcome back here to the Powerade halftime show in this USL League 2 matchup between the Glens and the Oakland Roots Project 5-1-0. The Glens find themselves trailing 1-0 at halftime. Let's take a look at some of those highlights from the first half.
The Glens, a little bit of a slow start. Here we have a dangerous play. Goalkeeper Hugo Dutour held onto the ball just too long while those Project 5-10-5-1-0 forwards are not giving the Glens any time to play with the ball in the back.
They pressed ferociously, did 5-1-0 in the first half, and found ways to exploit mistakes. You brought up Hugo Dutour. Well, we'll see one of those mistakes a little bit later in just a few moments. But this was the chance from Estrada, but Cyrell with a big, big save, paws it away. You'd expect nothing less from a man who's been signed and played in USL Championship than the Mahi effort on that left foot. And here's that goal we mentioned. Hugo Dutour, pressed by Josh Redfield, backs into the goal, and an unforced error, or maybe forced, depending on how much credit you want to give Josh Redfield. But that's the only goal in this first half, although there were opportunities. Overall, what did you make of it, Kylen? What did you make of that first half?
Not a bad half for the Glens. Unfortunate that they're down 1-0 right now, just based on a set piece mistake, if you want to call it a mistake, by goalkeeper Hugo Dutour. However, credit to Project 5-1-0, an in-swinger on a corner kick, always a dangerous ball to be played in and a difficult ball to handle. The Glens had a lot better run of play as the half went on. They had better possession. And they were able to crank some shots. We just saw that junior Mahi opportunity, a great opportunity, and a nice rip from Mahi with that left foot. Let's take a look at the stats.
Those halftime stats. We can see exactly how many shots the Glens had in that first half. Two shots, one on goal. Again, the one that touches the crossbar, although technically on the frame of the goal, does not count as a shot on goal. And just those two opportunities for the Glens.
The Glens did a good job of forcing corner kicks. They had a couple of opportunities down at the end line where they were able to earn a corner. They have the edge there 3-2. They just need to get on the end of one of those balls.
Or even that free kick that was in the corner that's similar to a corner but not an actual corner. You'd look for maybe Bakuzi, with Bakuzi's height being 6'4", Charalaghi being 6'2", to maybe try and get in there and win one of those in the second half. Those moments will maybe prove crucial. Again, set pieces can bail you out of situations that maybe you wouldn't like to find yourself in otherwise.
Set pieces can be the difference maker in every game, and that's been the difference maker in 1-0 so far today. With Project 5-1-0 scoring on a corner, the Glens need to do the same thing.
Again, halftime score here, 1-0 to Oakland Roots Project 5-1-0. Over the San Francisco Glens at Skyline College. When we come back, you're going to see a little bit of a special interview with Diego Grande and Dominic Valdivia on Live in the Bay when we come back.
I think it's a good community to come into because everyone gets along very well, and there's a lot of different opportunities that the Glens can give you. It's a very exciting club to be a part of.
I think I've gotten way better being with the Glens, and I'm hoping I can stay with them.
My goal is to become a soccer player when I grow up. That's my dream.
Ever since I joined, like, I was always welcome, so I always think of it like that. You have to welcome other people.
For me and for the coaches that I've worked with, building community, that's something that we talk about a lot.
We have amazing coaches, and now I'm going to MLS next.
Like many, I think, played with a number of clubs in the city. They all have different, you know, good attributes, and we liked the ambition of the Glens, quite frankly.
facility project that we have at Treasure Island is imperative to meet the ambitions of the club.
I feel like that would give me another opportunity because more people would come there now that the Glens would have their own stadium, so I think more scouts would come there.
The facility to us represents, you know, the ability for the Glens to think big and to think about the next level and really truly model themselves after what has really worked well in other parts of the world.
When we speak about creating an environment, a club environment, you do want to have your own space, and this is going to give us a huge boost in terms of creating that environment that is specific to the Glens community.
If you love soccer, why not be together?
The goal here at the club is to be able to raise private donations. Where that money goes to is directly into building the facility. We're going to have a state-of-the-art 11x11 full-size soccer field. We'll be able to have 299 fields on that as well. We want to have two practice fields off to the side, as well as a futsal court. So being able to use that money and build something that we can call a home for our youth club, our first team players, and for the larger community is something that we think is very, very important.
We are unbelievably excited for this next step in the history of our club, but it won't happen without your help. Go to the website below to learn about our great donation opportunities. Again, thank you so much for being a part of our community, and up the Glens.
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 Are you looking for something to do this weekend with the whole family that won't break the bank? Well, how about a day at the soccer field? Joining us now from the SF Glens is number 7 Diego and number 6 Dominic. Thank you guys so much for joining me today. I appreciate you guys coming on the show. It's awesome to have some athletes in the house.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you for having us. We're really glad to be here. Before we start, we actually brought you something. So ooh, here's a Glens jersey.
Name on the back and everything. Back,
yeah. To number 4 for
Channel 4
News.
Oh, that's what's up. Look at this. My last name on the back, Horton. That's what's up. I appreciate that. Thank you, fellas.
Of course.
Thank you guys so much.
Of course.
All right, let's learn a little bit more about the SF Glens. I'm going to be rocking this, by the way. How did the club first come together?
So the club started in, I believe it was 1965, and it's just been kind of going on since then. It's started as just a youth soccer team, and it's now developed into what we are. So it's kind of like a summer league team for college athletes, and we're kind of slowly transitioning, hopefully, to be a professional team in the next couple of years.
Mm-hmm. So you guys are semi-professional, correct?
Yeah, in the USL League 2 division.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and talk to me a little bit about the age that young men come to play on the team, and then what the team kind of ends up looking like.
So we have a youth program. They're called the San Francisco Glens, and I used to play on that team. And I went through the ranks, U15, U17, U19, and now I'm on the first team. So that's a way, a pathway for the young players to reach the first team. And like he plays on USF, and he's a college team, Division I in San Francisco.
Awesome.
So it's just a bunch of different players who can play on this team, whether from the academy team or players around like from local colleges.
And what's the brotherhood like on this team? Are you guys super close? What's it like on and off the field?
Yeah, I mean, obviously all of us come from different schools, different places, but once we're on the same team, we all just kind of click. And throughout the season, our chemistry has just grown and grown. As you can see that in our latest results, we've done really well. So, yeah.
Well, speaking of results, I was looking at your guys' Instagram account, doing the creep thing on social media, which we all do. I'm not ashamed. So after I looked, I saw that you guys are actually in first place. Is this correct?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, we're top of the table currently, sitting pretty right now.
So no big deal, but you guys are a pretty good team.
We try to be a good team. We're starting to figure out how we want to play and how we want to be as a team. And as you said, we're looking pretty good in first place, but we got to keep going. We have a half a season left, so these next 6 games are big.
6 games left. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, how did you each get started in soccer individually? Let's start with you.
So I started playing when I was 4. My dad played when he was younger, and then my older brother also played. Mm-hmm. So it was just kind of something I jumped straight into when I was 4 years old, and I just fell in love with it and just have played ever since then. So yeah.
And where do you currently play? Because you said it's for young athletes who are also trying to get into college and all that. So where do you play? This program has helped prepare you for the next level of soccer?
Me personally, I got signed 2 years ago. I didn't get a lot of playing time because, you know, I had a lot of things to improve on. And so it made me realize that there's a lot of things I need to do personally if I want to be able to play on the first team. And I took that to heart, and I trained a lot. And now I'm able to finally play on the first team. So it just gives you something to work towards, I feel like. And yeah. I feel like me personally, I feel like I've done that, and I want to continue doing that.
Well, hard work always pays off, mm-hmm. always. And what about you, Dominic?
I mean, with the coaching staff we have, like Gabe and Jimmy, there's tons of connections around the team and around the club that could help me get to the next step, which is obviously professional after college. So, mm-hmm. yeah, it's a great stepping stone in the path.
All right, now tell people, all of our viewers, where they can watch you guys. When's your next game?
This Saturday.
This Saturday.
Skyline College.
Yeah, 3 p.m.
Skyline College, mm-hmm. 3 p.m. Now, you guys have a ton of fans, a lot of friends and family. Mm-hmm. What's the crowd like? Set the scene a little bit for me.
If you go, it'll be a jam-packed game. A lot of our, like I said, our youth program, a lot of the young players love being there, supporting us, chanting. So they'll be there. All the youth teams will hopefully be there, and all of our friends and family will be there. So you should be there. High energy.
Mm-hmm. Rock the house, right? Bring the high energy in. Mm-hmm. Which one of you guys is going to score a goal for KRON 4?
Diego's got 5 goals in 4 games, so
wow.
I believe it's him.
Okay.
I feel like we keep it going.
Yeah. Okay, no big deal. Worth the wait, right? Yeah. All right, well, thank you guys so much for joining us on the show. We really appreciate it. And listen, you guys can also support them. Check out the SF Glens for yourself this Saturday, June 18th at 3 p.m. on the field or on KRONon. We'll have links on our website, liveinthebay.tv. Stay right there, because after the break, we have a look at what is coming up on tomorrow's show, including a winner of a top musical achievement. But as we head to break, let's check in with Kevin Frazier from Entertainment Tonight with a look at what they have coming up.
Hello, Glens family. I'm Jessica Hewins. I'm going to be the new DOC for the SF Glens on the girls' side. I'm excited to get started and ready to meet all of you guys.
We are extremely excited to welcome Jessica into our club and community. We acknowledge that there is significant room for growth in our girls program and believe that Jessica is perfect to help us reach our goals.
I'm really excited to start with the Glens. I've seen over the years how the boys' side has really developed. They just got the full MLS next side. And then I've noticed, like, on the girls' side, it's pretty small club. What I'm really excited about is that it's small now, and that allows the foundation for us to, like, really start to build it. I really believe in a holistic approach to coaching and the culture of a club. And so I think for me to start, I think the biggest thing is building trust within the coaches, the players. So I want to be out there at practices, at games, getting to meet all the players, getting to meet all the coaches, and then getting a really good idea of where we can build upon. I love coaching at the older age groups and the college, because it's a little more focused on the game, and there's all the aspects of, like, the competitiveness, the tactics, the scouting, recruiting, and watching film. So I get kind of that feel of you know, a high level coaching experience, but then I really have a passion for the youth level in building, you know, these characters and these players and youth who are going to grow up and kind of make a difference. I would say in an ideal Glens player, I'm really big on core values, respect, it's humility, and really mindset and a passion for the game. So I want to see a player that maybe they're not the best skilled, maybe they're not the most physical, but they have the want to work hard, to get better, to love the game, and be a part of our community.
Welcome back to Skyline College, as we are preparing you for the second half of this Southwest matchup between the San Francisco Glens and the Oakland Roots Project, 5-1-0. The Glens find themselves trailing 1-0 at halftime off the Hugo Dutour own goal, officially deemed an own goal by the scorekeepers, as we prepare for the second half. Kylen, in the second half, if you're Gabe Saucedo, what is that team talk like at halftime?
The Glens need to do a better job of possessing, playing quick 1-2 touch passes on the ground, and then moving off the ball in this second half. There were too many times where the ball got played backward, played through the back line, and then you look forward and everyone's standing flat-footed, ball watching. Ball watching, a term often used in soccer just to describe when you're staring at someone else using the ball with no thought of how can I be getting involved in the play. And especially the Glens forwards, also midfielders, need to do a better job of moving to get open, giving options to those defenders when they get the ball back, especially because the defenders need to make quick decisions based on how high this Project 510 forwards and this front line is pressing. They're pressing very high. They're making it very difficult for them to possess out the back. So they've got to be ready to make quick decisions, but that starts with teammates moving off the ball.
And we've seen the technical ability, and we've seen flashes of it when they move off the ball, possess quick 1-2 passes, the way that they've been able to cut through teams, whether it's Marin or during that road trip, or even today, there's been glimpses, there's been flashes of it, but the look to kind of solidify that and find a sustained spell of that as we are preparing. There's a substitution being prepared for Oakland Roots Project 510. Daniel Gomez will make his way into this one. Sophomore from Stanislaus State.
The Glens did have flashes of that ball movement and possession in that first half. They have to sustain it and find a rhythm on offense. That's what they've not done yet. They've not been consistent with that ball movement. There were too many times where the Glens back line got a ball back, didn't see any options, and just had to boot it forward, and that's just a giveaway. And suddenly Project 510 is coming down your throats, and you're on your heels on defense.
You see there, Edgar Cruz subbed out there. Daniel Gomez coming on, replacing him. Likely solidifying into that central midfield location.
Edgar Cruz did a good job of creating some problems for the Glens back line. He is incredibly fast and just runs so hard at every single ball. I'm surprised to see him be subbed out. Not sure what the tactic is going on for the Project 510 coaching staff, but he looked good to me in the first half and a dangerous player up top.
Maybe a bit of rotation considering they did play just 2 days ago on Thursday.
That is another factor. Playing Thursday to Saturday is a quick turnaround in soccer. 90 minutes wears on you. It's incredibly exhausting. The legs could be tired just 2 days later still. Project 510 hasn't looked it though.
No, they have not. They've come out ferocious, if I would describe their press in the first half. Maybe even relentless until they got that goal, and then they were still pressing and relaxed. But their legs have looked fresh, they've looked eager, and they've looked up for it. As we will get underway, Saldana will play back to Bracken Sarah.
I'm looking for the Glens to play more connected in the second half.
Can they find ways to find those longer spells, those longer strings of passes, even if they're quick? Although, with the wind at their backs, they may also look to try and find those over-the-top balls in a similar way to 510. The only way to find out will be to see how they approach it, as Dutour will do just that. Long ball headed away by Dossman. Simeon thrown in to Cronte. A little flick. No one there on the same page as them, though. And if that's the case, it will be a giveaway, and in this case, a goal kick. Dossman, I talked about earlier, his time with Mainz in Germany. He's been cool, calm, and collected on the ball, but also a Michigan commit, as that ball will be played in from Kevin Lowe, trying to find the sprinting Mahi.
The Glens have done a good job of challenging every 50-50 ball. We saw a dangerous chance potentially be created for Mahi because the Glens are challenging and winning the 50-50 off the punt, off the kick at midfield.
And now with the wind at their backs, the Glens now pressing extremely deep into the 5-1-0 half. Nearly creating a giveaway there. A head forward, Max Kretzian trying to check to it. Estrada, a ball for Grande, unable to be connected. Ruiz Duran, left back, in a centrally midfield attacking position. And we talked about his experience at Santa Clara as an attacking player. There, during his career, 17 goals, 21 assists overall, including 3 goals and 10 assists last season. He'll also not steal, but he'll take the captain's armband from Nicholas Dossman. The press a little more relaxed in this moment. And now they'll start to go. Five-one-zero, though, doing well to connect out of it. And Karami does pretty darn well there with Kevin Lowe getting in his face, trying to win it. And they played out of that fantastically. Pressure relieved. And all of a sudden, you have more time and space. Bracken Serra checking to it. He'll be joining the USF back line. The back line for the Glens, the USF squad. He'll be joining them next season. As will Kretzian as well. Mahi, though. Space as Sarah will try and battle a bit of a shoulder, a shove, and it will do enough to push him off. Goes down maybe a little easily, but Mahi, frustrated with the call, didn't like the decision.
Before that play, the push from Sarah Bracken looked like that could have been a foul. The arm was out, rather than just shoulder to shoulder on Junior Mahi. If the arm comes out, that could also be a call, or should be a call, depending on how tightly the refs are officiating a game.
And it looks like there's also been a substitution in the referee crew, as fourth official Christian Zepian looks to have taken the central position. Mahi flicks it behind his leg, out side of the boot ball. Kevin Lowe in an effort. His high-powered effort will hit the back of the net. Well, not the back of the net the Glens would have liked, but back of the net
not
all the same.
Not that back of the net. A nice strike by Kevin Lowe. He just needs to get over the ball a little bit more, head over, keep it down. But a great look on goal for the Glens after battling to get that cross off, and that's where the offense starts.
Nice one-touch combination between the central midfield three for the Glens.
A player I'd like to see get the ball more in this second half is midfielder Jonathan Estrada. He's playing that attacking central midfield role. He should be the facilitator for the Glens attack. He did not have the ball at his feet nearly enough in that first half. Part of it is he needs to be more active in checking to the ball, getting open, and getting involved, and helping connect that back line to the Glens strikers.
As you said in our last match, Jimmy Conrad says that he has the sauce.
We still haven't figured out what sauce it is. All I know is it's something nicer than Prego.
Yeah.
Geoffrey.
That was the only hard conclusion after the last match. I guess there will, in addition to the churro power rankings, the churro filling power rankings, there will also have to be a sauce tier list as well.
Which obviously requires sauce taste testing.
Yes. Can you tell that we're hungry?
Right. Estrada does, though, absolutely have the sauce. You see when the ball is at his feet, just the technical abilities that he has. He's played at Cal the last several seasons. Had quite a bit of success. Also history playing for the LA Galaxy in their club program down in Southern California.
Had a goal as well for Los Dos, their USL championship side. He will find Valdivia. Hernandez streaking back. Valdivia pushes it onto his left. That driven ball deflected away. And it will be a corner. Another set piece for the Glens.
Corner kick. San Francisco Glen.
I don't mind the look on goal there from Valdivia. He has a strong left foot. While he did have several defenders in front of him, it's deflected out for a corner kick. The Glens now at the edge. 4-2 in corners. They've got to capitalize, though, on these set pieces.
Valdivia, right foot. Can't get it over the first man. Saldana, and he'll have to repeat the same gesture.
Not enough on that corner kick there. Easy handle.
Is he also hitting that with his right, too? His weaker foot, unless his true ambidextrous nature.
Yes, he plays on the left side and has a strong left foot. You'd believe he's a lefty. I'm surprised that there's not another player on the Glens looking to make that right-footed inswinger right now.
That ball will have even more than maybe required or necessary, maybe overcompensating for that first one. No one in the area code of that corner.
What we saw with those two corners, one not enough on it, the other just way too much. You've got to find that sweet spot of trying to land the ball at the back of the six where you've got your teammates crashing the goal, someone looking to get on the end of it. A driven ball towards the back of the six is what you want from a corner kick.
A cheeky little flick from Carlos Cruz, but a backward touch from Juan O'Neill, bringing himself back into pressure. Cruz, no one there. Mahi, his effort will be blocked away by sliding Bracken Serra. And Karami has space. Saldana, clever touch by Bakuzi, and Karami will try and get there, but a strong shoulder. Kevin Lowe, though, not out of danger yet. Karami trying to find Carlos Cruz. And 5-1-0 will eventually regain steady possession and just try and reset. Strong recovery, though, from the Glen center backs to snuff out that chance. Kretien, though, corner of the box. Kretien's right-footed effort, curling, big save. A big, big save by Timothy Cyrell. Full stretch, punches it away.
Kretien did a good job of curling and chipping that ball with his right foot from a difficult angle on the left side of the box. He's able to force that Project 5-1-0 goalkeeper to make a tough save. And a deflection can also be a second opportunity. Kretien is the player that Coach Sosedo calls the spark plug for this Glens offense.
Lorenzo Hernandez, that's a bit of a tug from Valdivia and will certainly be a card here. A yellow for Tom Valdivia.
That's a clear-cut yellow card on a breakaway like that. Also, though, a tactical foul.
You can take another look at it. No real protestation from Valdivia.
A smart foul there by Valdivia. Forcing the free kick does give your teammates and your team time to get behind the ball, to reset, to organize, to mark up, rather than looking at a breakaway situation where you're chasing and that Project 5-1-0 forward is attacking on net.
Bracken Serra will stand over this one. He is a threat from set pieces. He leads 5-1-0 with 3 goals this season, all of them from set pieces, 1 a free kick, 2 penalties, although this looks mighty out of the range of even the strongest leg. His ball be served in. That's dangerous. Josh Redfield slid through, but couldn't get a foot on it.
That's a great ball by Bracken Serra. Driving it low, bouncer just across the 18 in a dangerous position. He just needed one of his teammates to get some body part on it, just redirect it towards goal.
And hard to deal with if you're a Glens player as well, running backwards towards your own goal, trying to make sure you don't put it on goal. You've already had one own goal in this match. Don't want another. We'd also like to thank Rudy's Tacos for all your tacos, burritos, and all your Mexican food favorites. Check out Rudy's Taco Truck in San Bruno. Or if you're at the game and you just love listening to our voices, call it at the same time, but you're watching a person, you can even just walk over to the parking lot and you can get some Rudy's Tacos.
Next up, Rudy's Tacos taste test, Geoffrey.
Yes.
We'll get the churros. We'll get the tacos.
Can we flag Ryan down right now to go get us some tacos?
We, of course, appreciate them being out here helping feed the crowd we've got at Skyline College. Some fans lined up.
No call there on that bump in the back. Mahi Can he fire it with his left? And an effort! Oh!
Hey, how on earth?
Just wide.
A great effort by Mahi with the left foot, looking to slot that ball far post. That's exactly where you want to play that, where you want to look to finish from that position in the 18. Let's take another look here.
The speed gets him into position, and then that left foot has almost been there. It's been sweet, but not as sweet as those churros. And once it is, the Glens may find their equalizer.
The Glens are creating a lot of opportunities in this second half. They have to finish one here.
Yeah, that chance, though, also started from a bump in the back on Brancancera. The 5-1-0 bench not happy with the officials again, voicing their displeasure. Brancancera.
As much as Project 510 isn't happy with the officiating, they seem to be getting more frazzled in this second half. Not just from the bench, the players on the field, they don't have the same rhythm they had in this first half. You can hear it in their voices, calling out to teammates. It's a little bit more chaotic in the second half for Project 510.
Still, they've been content to just keep possession, not foray too aggressively forward.
You've got to give a lot of credit to the Glens defense. They are doing a great job of getting behind the ball, not letting anything through, aside from that one dangerous yellow, which was the right play to make there. In general, they're staying organized. They're keeping a good shape. They're communicating. They're not allowing the Project 510 strikers to get any easy opportunities.
And Dossman there deemed to have clipped the back of Kretzian's heels. Yellow card for another 510 player. Kretzian, though, still in a heap. You definitely don't want to see that. If you're a Glens fan, he's been the catalyst of this offense with 3 goals and 4 assists in their 6 matches. A golden boot winner with Christchurch United in New Zealand.
Kretien, a transfer, joining USF this season. Another Don on the field for the Glens, and they've got plenty of them. That entire back line, plus Kevin Lowe just in front of the back line in that holding central midfielder position, which is great for chemistry and communication out the back when you've all played college ball together.
Pre-existing synergy and chemistry that they hope to carry over to the short USL League Two season.
Kretien is back up and running. However, it looks like he's running with a little bit of a limp. The Glens warming up. A couple of players on their sideline, it looks like. Kretien may be coming out of the game.
You might expect to see Josh Deborah, who's been battling the last few weeks, trying to win that starting spot. And Grande, a hard challenge on Dossman. The foul, rightly called. Deborah getting ready to come on.
Deborah, another player with no shortage of college experience, playing at Santa Clara, starting 13 games of 4 that he played in this past season, 5 goals, 2 assists, a transfer from Penn State.
And a Glens returner, played with the squad in 2019. Their last match against, they went down and won against the Ventura County Fusion. Their last win of that season was away at Ventura. He was a big part of that match as well. A second generation Glen. We mentioned that as well. His father played for the Glens. The men's team was a national amateur finalist. And Shayan Charalaghi as well, another second generation Glen who looked to have maybe been nipped earlier and now is also laboring. But Deborah will officially make his way on here trying to be a difference maker in this one. And it looks like it'll actually be Diego Grande subbing off here. Chrétien may go out wide.
Your attention, please. Substitution for SF Glens. Number 19.
Granze not able to add any more goals to his five-goal tally so far this season. He won goal of the week last week. He won't be doing the same, unfortunately, this week. Mahi's left foot, bending, touch from Simeonuk, scissor, it'll be blocked away. Mahi, touch, little flick, Mahi flicked over, but it'll be out of bounds. He went over the end line, it will be a goal kick for Timothy Cyrell.
Deborah going up top at just the right time too, ahead of a corner kick. He's got some size at 6'4".
Also another danger on set pieces.
The Glens have got to finish one of these corners. That is six now on the match. You have to capitalize when you earn those set pieces that you work so hard for. That last corner, just still not quite enough on it. A driven ball to the back of the six is ideal. It was middle of the six. A little bit too lofted. Still, Nathan Simeon did a good job to battle and try to get a foot on that last corner.
Juan O'Neill down here. Former Santa Clara Bronco, as the Project 510 trainer will come out to him. The bench for the Oakland Roots, having a chat with the fourth official, Brian Cordova Munoz.
This has been a physical game, as expected. And we're being told that his left eye is the area of concern right now.
An unfortunate area, maybe a finger, a wayward finger or elbow. Hopefully he'll be all right, be able to continue. His last season at Santa Clara, played in 18 games, including 17 starts. Also was a transfer from Assumption College before that. As he'll make his way to his feet, and he'll be accompanied to the sideline by the Glen, or the 510 trainer. It'll be a draw ball here. As Kevin Lowe will just lump it back to Dossman.
A show of sportsmanship there whenever you have a player who gets injured like that and there's a jump ball.
Drop ball.
Drop ball. Traditionally, you'll just give it a boot back.
All that Warriors coverage getting to your head.
That's true. I'm right on the heels of covering the NBA Finals.
Simeon. A nifty turn.
A nice turn and good composure by Nathan Simeon. The Glens are doing a better job of possessing in this second half, as we've seen the ball being worked out wide, worked back centrally, more movement off the ball. And that's made a difference in creating more opportunities in this half.
They've enjoyed the wind at their backs, trying to make the most of it. Charlaghi's touch is too big, and an opportunity for a long ball over the top, but it's not there. They had Carlos Cruz, who was trying to take advantage of the space that used to be occupied by Charalaghi when Charalaghi had that touch. But they weren't able to exploit it.
More great footwork on that last play by Nathan Simeon. Not only does he have speed, he's quick. He has such quick feet and excellent technical abilities in tight spaces.
Velasquez to Valdivia. A cut inside, right-footed cross, deflected away by Bracken Serra. Kevin Lowe, might he have a hit here? He did it earlier. Simeon, his cross will be blocked away by Carlos Cruz.
Coach Tocedo said this is exactly what he wanted his Glens team to be doing and looking to do on offense, utilize the flanks and try to swing balls into dangerous positions in front of the goal, with players running on to get on the end of a cross.
And they'll have another opportunity to try and get on a cross here as it'll be another corner. Mounting pressure here from San Francisco. They'll play fairly quickly short to Estrada, who attempts to turn but will actually just try and find Mahi out wide.
Carlos, that looks like a push.
Carlos Cruz into the back of him. But Lowe will play Velasquez in a dangerous space. His effort touched away, maybe off of the back of Deborah. Or a 5-1-0 player in the case of central referee Christian Zepien. And it'll be another corner.
This is the Glens' eighth corner of the game. They need to capitalize on these set pieces.
And it's up Charalaghi, out won by Javier Ruiz Duran. They likely played against each other in their collegiate season. And a handball from Bacuzzi.
It was a handball, an unlucky one. The ball just flipping up off his foot, bouncing off the hand. However, if it is redirected in any way, you've got to call it. It is Sunday, 1:00. The Glens have done such a good job of creating set pieces and corner kicks.
Saldana's in. Sorry to interrupt. Behind Bacuzzi. Bacuzzi was looking for an offside flag. But he'll give a bump and Dutour will collect. They'll try and find Long the other way. Deborah putting everything he has to try and get there. And Cyrell will quickly fling it out.
Project 510 getting ready for a frenzy of substitutions. As we approach the 70th minute mark, now's the time where legs start to get tired. You're getting worn down. The Roots looking to inject some fresh legs and energy into their offense.
Corner number 9. There'll be a substitution here. Javier Bedoya Vera will come on, 15 years old, has a goal this season. He will make his way on, as will Brandon Zelaya, a freshman at UCLA, former Quakes Academy man who was the number 3 ranked prospect in Northern California coming out of high school. And Brennan Mallett, a Cornell freshman, will take the place of Josh Redfield at center back.
Bedoya Vera playing with Project 510 at 15 years old is so impressive. Playing amongst collegiate players, 20, 21, 22 years old, in an incredibly physical and competitive atmosphere. Not an easy situation for a 15-year-old to be in.
Mahi's cross curls away from everyone. Nobody really had a chance at it.
9 corner kicks now for the Glens, and not a single goal off any of them. If I were head coach Gabe Sosedo, this week in practice, we're doing corners over and over and over.
That ball will be out and curl back in. Be a throw in here. Mallett will instantly be matched up with Max Chrétien, who blocks Bracken Serra's clearance.
One thing Coach Sosedo has said he loves about Chrétien's game is the pressure he applies up top and how physical and strong he plays. He forces defenders to work to get the ball out of the back.
They'll need that with the way that they've been pressing and the hopes of creating a miscue. They'll take their time on the throw in. Content, up a goal. Bedoya Vera flying in, but the boot of Kevin Lowe boots it away. Kind of a scorpion kick forward, trying to find Chrétien. It'll be a throw in for the Glens down in the corner.
The Glens continue to press in this second half, doing a great job of creating opportunities, playing very physical, winning 50-50s as we saw on this last possession, and then creating set pieces by getting to the end line, getting deflections.
The long throw, flicked down, Estrada blocked away. Dossman, another corner.
I mean, this is incredible at this point. 10 corner kicks for the Glens through 72 minutes of play and not one goal.
I mean, I think the count from Sesame Street would even have trouble counting this high, the number of corners the Glens have had. This ball in. Simeon tried to win it, but Lorenzo Hernandez looked to have gotten the better of him. And Batoya Vera, or sorry, Zelaya, straight into Kevin Lowe. No call in numbers forward. Oh, that final pass, though, was lacking. Bracken Serra wanted it, but didn't get it exactly where he wished it had gone. Kretien, clever move. He'll try and find Estrada, but the touch isn't there. Zelaya battling against Bacuzzi. That's a big size mismatch.
The 15-year-old.
So Bedoya Vera, the 15-year-old.
Yes.
Bryn Zelaya, number 15.
Not at all confusing.
Mahi. He's tried a few of those now, those flicks. None of them have amounted to much. And his press is alone, as there will now be a space on the right side for 5-1-0. Bracken Serra points, calls his shot, but that ball with the wind will just curl inside Karami. Not quick enough, and that's a bad giveaway. Bedoya Vera, the 15-year-old, his pass will be snatched up by Valdivia.
The Glens did a good job of cleaning that up. They have to be careful with those passes back, and Dutour has to know when it's time to go, when it's time to give that ball a one-touch boot.
Pass was too soft from Velasquez. Yeah, we talked about Kevin Lowe, his not his lack of fitness, but the injury that he's been carrying a bit. Still in this one, hoping that he might be the key for the Glens. That'll be a free kick as Estrada ends up on the turf. Bracken Serra will plead his case, but Zapien, the central referee.
Another big chance here for the Glens to swing a ball in and get on the end of it in the box. They've got to get on the end of one of these. To me, it's been a combination. They need better services. And then also you need someone in the box with killer instincts who's going to get there first. And if not get there first, get to that second ball.
Big moment here as the clock hits 75. Served and headed, diving, and it's in! It's Charalaghi off the chest! Equalized for the Glens. 1-1, game on here at Skyline College.
Let's take another look at this one. A very dangerous ball played in a perfect position towards the back post, bouncing a difficult ball for those 5-1-0 defenders to handle, and Charalaghi is in the right place at the right time, running on goal, and all you have to do in those moments, just tap it in. Just redirect it. Don't do too much.
In the words of Happy Gilmore, just give it a little tap. Tap it in.
Charalaghi, give it a little tap. And that's all you need. That's all you need. Too many times in some balls, even at the edge of the six, you'll see players sky it straight into the air because they're trying to do too much and really rip a ball that doesn't need to be ripped. Just redirect it.
Nathan Simeon will make his way off for the Glens, as will Junior Mahi. Replacing them, Ryan Dieter and Danny Estrada. Plenty of time for either side to jump in front. Estrada, he has that filth, that sauce. He does well to just keep it.
Well, now we've got two Estradas on the field. Jonathan Estrada. Danny Estrada, another player who substituted in, a player out of SF State, originally from Southern California.
Dieter combining with Bacuzzi. Flying in is Brennan Mallett.
A neat flick there by Bacuzzi to keep the ball in, using the outside of his foot to curl it back into the course of play. results in a throw-in for the Glens.
Not exactly a place you'd expect to find your starting center back, but he does well. The Bora, a shoulder. Kretzian trying to get in front of it, but the ball just runs too quickly away from him. And Cruz tries to find the run of Brandon Zelaya.
The Glens are just dominating this second half with a majority of the possession and creating so many opportunities on goal. It seems like it's just going to be a matter of time before they knock another one in the back of the net.
No foul there. Dieter fell down, unable to get back up. And Estrada, a hard challenge, keeps it. He's going to draw more defenders with three on him, and Bedoya Vera wins it. Kevin Lowe is equal. 1-2 between Dieter.
Estrada did a good job of tracking back, getting involved defensively from that attacking midfielder position in order to stop that 5-1-0 attack before it happened, before they crossed midfield.
Dieter recently subbed on, trying to make a bit of a difference. Fresh legs, trying to take advantage. Deborah. Dieter will just lay it back. 11 men now behind the ball, but they'll try and step up and force the Glens maybe into a mistake.
Right here, the Glens falling into their old trap. Not enough movement off the ball there as they played it back to their back line. Midfielders, forwards, you've got to be checking, you've got to be looking, you've got to be moving to get open when that ball is played back. I heard Coach Saucedo yelling, move, from the sideline.
Estrada with Bedoya Vera, the youngster, on his back. He's able to keep it. And the Glens will have to try and find another opportunity, whether it's set piece. Ooh, a little ball roll from Bakuzi. Leia from Deborah. They've enjoyed his hold-up play so far in this one, as he gives a little shove, and he's not happy with that call at all. Getting in Zappian's face, but they sort their differences out quickly enough. And his work rate will hopefully be fruitful for the Glens.
With the Glens spending so much of time in their attacking third, really dominating the second half, they just have to be careful not to get out of position defensively and preventing any type of counterattack.
Zelaya, nice skill. You can see why he was ranked so highly. Springs it out. Carlos Cruz. Ruiz Duran in his effort. Not too challenging. 5-1-0. Asking for a foul on Zelaya. Saying Bakuzi gave him a bump off the ball. Zappian says, get up. Nothing doing. We encourage you to watch the next game here on KRON on Sunday, July 10th against Central Valley Fuego 2 here at Skyline College, 1 p.m. kickoff, the start time of that one.
That was a great kick from goalkeeper Hugo Dutour for the Glens. Going way past the center circle on that kick. Really strong, almost creating a corner kick off the deflection.
The wind certainly helping him there. Teeter.
Absolutely.
Quick, and a great recovery forces a turnover. Jonathan Estrada tries to check to the ball, but Bracken Sarah goes for a nutmeg on Andy Velásquez. And that's a sliding challenge from Dossman. This game's chippy, and Zelaya is held by Bakuzi. Bakuzi with another little bump. These two have been battling even with their size difference. Bedoya Vera combining with Karami. Well done.
The Glens have to keep their defensive shape.
Carlos Cruz on the wing. Danny Estrada wins it from him. Nothing from the referee. And Deborah with acres of space. Those long legs.
The Glens are in a three-on-three situation here on the attack.
Good ball to find Dieter. Estrada. That ball just kind of deflected off Rack and Sarah. Aimlessly. Valtivia will take the throw. Not much time, and that's a clear handball. Arm outstretched.
Doesn't get any more clear than that when the arm is completely away from the body and completely redirects the ball on the bounce.
No matter how quickly you tuck it behind your back.
the old trick.
Did not happen. Danny Estrada. His cross popped up by Brendan Mallett. He'll try and head it away. Ruiz Duran, no pressure though. Can take a touch and move forward.
That was a great cross by Danny Estrada, just putting it at the top of the six, low. A little bit of a bounce on the ground for one of his teammates to get a foot on it. That's exactly the position you want to play that cross in.
Deborah tried to offer that hold up play, but his touch, his pass let him down. And 5-1-0 will try and find the release valve. And Bracken Sarah, a little dummy. Bates and Dieter, who will now have to try and recover against Lorenzo Hernandez. We'll play Karami, who returns it. That ball is driven in, but Dutour is able to get it, and he'll just boot it forward. Kind of two-on-two with the numbers here. And a big header away from Mallett. He's come on, and he's been tested early.
I like the quick punt there from Dutour, looking to catch the Project 5-1-0 defenders off guard. A two-on-two situation with forwards and defenders is majorly going to be an advantage to the attack.
That throw in will go to Deborah. And he just kind of is unable to do anything definitively with it. And 5-1-0 will gladly take it and say thank you. Doya Vera, he's been energetic and lively since coming on.
The Glens have really gotten into a rhythm in the second half, finding feet, swinging the ball around, moving off the ball, switching fields as we're seeing them do right now. And once they get it wide, getting it forward and swinging dangerous balls in. That's what's been working for them. They need to keep doing that and try to get a game winner here in the last five, plus stoppage time.
They've done it before in other matches this season. And that effort, oh my goodness! Kevin Lowe put some juice behind it, but unfortunately it's not on frame.
Lowe is the engine that makes this Glens team go. He is so critical to their possession and facilitating the attack while also being crucial to their defense, staying organized, communicating, and he mixes it up on every single 50-50 ball that comes his way.
We talked about Woody Go, the duration he has so far. And there he is again.
If he's playing through any knee soreness, you can't tell. Because he is not holding back, still going strong into every tackle. And cranking one like he just did on goal.
Combination play. Well done, Kretien by Mallett. He'll put it on his right before playing Dieter.
That give and go with Valdivia making a run forward is exactly what was missing in the first half. The pass and move.
Well won, though. The press does its job. But Kretien gives it away. Charalaghi against Elia. Came through the back of him. Deemed a foul.
The Glens can't spend too much time arguing. They've got to get back, get their eye on the ball.
3 minutes left. Likely won't be too much added time with not too many stoppages.
There was the eye injury, though.
Yes.
Could add a few moments.
Deborah still on it. On the wing, Deborah. A move or two, his efforts will be cleared away by Mallet.
Deborah did a good job of staying composed with so many defenders on him, getting to the end line, cutting it back, and swinging a ball in on the ground with that left foot.
Before this throw, Jonathan Estrada will make his way off, and Jake Himmelstein will replace him. The Cal man, who was All-State and All-CIF in high school.
The Glens looking for a long throw here. That one didn't quite have it.
Not enough juice. But Estrada takes it back. Kevin Lowe. And Mallet steps up and wins another big challenge. Karami laying it off, trying to find Mallet, who had gone far forward.
It looked like the Glens could have been in trouble there. What an effort by Kevin Lowe to get back, get behind the ball and challenge. Stopping that 5-1-10 potential counterattack.
That cross ball, Deborah kind of waited for it. Maybe could have gone further to it to win it, but they'll still keep it with the throw. Himmelstein, oh, that's unfortunate. 5-1-0 will take it. Maybe content to leave here with a draw. Although a draw isn't the worst thing if you're the Glens. Again, you'd hold the head-to-head tiebreaker over 5-1-0 at the end of the season if it's a direct tiebreak. But knowing Gabe Saucedo, they will not be content to just go out with a draw.
They shouldn't be content with a draw because the Glens have had so many opportunities in the better run of play in the second half. They created 10 corner kicks in this game, in addition to so many set pieces and free kicks. The Glens have dominated this second half. They absolutely will be and should be disappointed with a 1-1 tie.
Karami, nice find. He'll get it back. And that ball is a little behind Bedoya Vera, excuse me. Unable to bring it down. 3 minutes of added time. Surprisingly large amount, considering I thought the stoppage, the injury stoppage in the first half was longer. But the Glens will take it. Dieter on the wing. Hernandez comes to him. A scissor and a ball in, and not too dangerous in. Oh, wow. The venom on that effort from Kevin Lowe blocked.
Kevin
I wouldn't want to eat one that close.
No. That's a ball that will leave a mark if you're a defender. Kevin Lowe really getting a lot on all of his strikes today. He's had three, I believe, on goal. He did such a good job of staying over the ball and really striking and following through.
Himmelstein trying to take a touch, but Ruiz Duran is able to win it. But they'll say he was held up on it. 5-1-0 will get the ball back. They'll just kind of play around in the back. That ball a little tough to control, and Mallet, his pass will be blocked. Glens will try and press here. A winner still on the cards.
The Glens have won every 50-50 ball, it feels like, in this second half. They are getting ahead on everything in the air and getting on every second ball as well.
And Estrada, a vital intervention to play it back. Dossman, though, he's been superb in this one. A big header away. We mentioned him in the pregame. He is certainly impressed and lived up to the hype.
That is a great step there by Valdivia, anticipating the pass.
Onto the foot of Kretien, and that challenge from Bracken Serra was crucial, but the danger isn't gone yet. The fans here, the largest turnout the Glens have had this season,
Valdivia backing way up like he's going to try to make a long throw with a big approach here.
And he will. It's in. Point up by Brennan Mallet. It'll do it again. It'll try and be shielded out. Himmelstein trying to get one. They will. Oh, it's still in, rather. And that ball is flicked. Three green shirts in the area trying to flick ahead towards that back post and beat Timothy Cyrell. Unfortunately, none of them able to connect.
What a ball by Valdivia, driving it into the center of the 18, right where you have bodies, right where you have teammates. That's exactly what you want to do. The Glens just unlucky. No one could quite redirect it on goal.
That ball again floats up into the wind. Bedoya Vera, good hold-up play. And they'll try and find an opportunity, a late winner for them. Karami Zelaya on the wing. He'll play inside Karami's effort. And that will not be exactly what he wished. And that will be full time here at Skyline College. A 1-1 draw between these two sides at the top of the table. The first game was close. This game was closer. A 1-1 draw between the San Francisco Glens and the Oakland Roots Project, 5-1-0 here at Skyline College. All in all, what did you make of it, Kylen?
The Glens did a great job of bouncing back in the second half and really doing a better job of playing connected soccer. Possessing the ball throughout the field, moving off the ball, finding teammates, playing the ball on the ground, and building their attack. They created so many opportunities in the second half. There's got to be frustration on the Glen side. They couldn't put another ball in the back of the net. So many set pieces, so many corner kicks, so many really dangerous shots on goal, and they just couldn't get a second one.
Not many chances from the run of open play. There were a few early on in the first half for both sides, but nothing besides set piece goals in this one. We talked about it early on. We talked about it at halftime. Set pieces, set pieces, set pieces. And in this game, that was what decided the outcome of the game, were one set piece on each side.
Set pieces can absolutely decide a game on any given day. The Glens, it was a combination of bad services on some balls, just not getting enough on it or getting way too much on it, not playing a driven ball, lofting the ball too much, and then just no one being able to get on the end of it. Sometimes you just got to throw your body at the ball. It just seemed like they were lacking some killer instinct in the box when they did get a ball in there into a dangerous position. Just no one could seem to get on the end of it.
And an unfortunate result. But when we come back, we will be interviewing our man of the match and a coach right when we come back. Stay with us.
Area soccer fans, get excited. There's more of the beautiful game coming your way. The SF Glens and KRON 4 are partnering up to bring you the best of USL League 2 action. Join us on KRON 4's live streaming app, KRONon.
It's hard to believe the Olympic Club Foundation has been around for 30 years of supporting youth athletics within the Bay Area communities.
That's a whole generation that we are changing.
They provided the funds that allowed the courts at McLaren Park here in San Francisco to be resurfaced.
There are hundreds of kids in Visitation Valley who are getting a chance to play on those courts.
We're supporting golf in East Palo Alto and swimming in Richmond and lacrosse in Oakland.
Our newest initiative is to build girls varsity lacrosse programs in every high school in Oakland. And the Olympic Club just being there consistently has helped us get to this point where we're going to be adding another 175 girls to our program.
It's really exciting to see all kids have that opportunity, especially women.
The support we provide, there's a big relief from the parents knowing that they're giving the kids opportunity to learn new things.
Congratulations, Olympic Club Foundation, on 30 years of investing in youth sports in the Bay Area.
30 years of giving wings to youth, fantastic. Thank you, Olympic Club Foundation.
You're going to introduce him. Welcome back to Skyline College, full-time here between the San Francisco Glens and Oakland Roots Project. 5-1-0, 1-1 is your final score. On the field, we have Kylen Mills with Shayan Charalaghi, the man of the match in this one.
Thanks, Geoffrey. Shayan, what did you see on that cross from Velásquez? How were you able to get on the end of it?
Well, I knew that we had a few corners throughout the game beforehand, and I knew that as long as we kept getting them, I would just like it would give me more opportunities to get on the end of one. And just looking up at the clock, I knew the game was going to end soon, and I just knew that like I had to do something in the moment. And just following the course of the ball in the back post, luckily it fell right to me, and I had an easy tap in. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Your team did such a great job of creating set pieces, corner kicks. What was working so well for your offense, especially in the second half?
Well, the second half, as you guys may have noticed, gets really windy here at Skyline, and we knew that would work to our advantage in the second half, and we wanted to attack going with the wind in the second half, and we knew that obviously the goal they scored, the wind was a huge factor, so we wanted to emulate that in a sense and, you know, put dangerous balls into the box, and we knew that the more of those crosses we had, we would get on the end of one of them eventually.
How as a team are you feeling after earning a draw? You were down 1-0, but it seemed like you could have had even more goals in the second half.
Yeah, but we came up against a good team, Project 5-1-0. I give credit to them. They have a good coaching staff, good players. They fought hard. They had something to prove after the last game we played, and we beat them on their home field. But we knew it was a big game. We knew we were up against, and we just wanted to give it all as a team effort. We knew that we could hang in the game and get our goal, and once the goal came, push on for the second. Unfortunately, it didn't come, but it's a vital point in the grand scheme of things, so we just keep going from here.
Moving forward, your coach Gabe Saucedo said that he wants you guys to continue playing like you're chasing the top spot, even though you're in the top spot. What is the mentality of this group as you move forward in league play?
Yeah, well, obviously we haven't done anything yet. We're happy with where we're at currently, but we know that there's 5 games left in the season. Anything can happen in those 5 games, and we just want to keep going 1 game at a time and give it 100%. We know that if we play 100%, the results will come, and we don't want to, you know, put unnecessary pressure on us. So we just take it 1 game at a time.
All right, Shayan Charalaghi, thank you so much. Our man of the match today at Skyline College. We'll be right back after a quick break.
We created Carlsberg 0-0 because even the best things can be better where our golf we've been.
Clean one-handed backhand is better. Balancing stuff is better. Whatever this is better.
We created Carlsberg.
Skipping your own ad is better. Parking in space, better.
So, can the best our golf we be make good things better? Probably.
Another post-game exclusive interview here on KRONon, full-time between the Glens and Project 5-1-0. 1-1 your final score. Kylen, this time with head coach Gabe Saucedo.
Thanks, Geoffrey. Coach Saucedo, you said before the game you wanted your team to come out and be aggressive and attack right from kickoff. How do you feel like they did?
Yeah, I don't think we did that at all. I thought we came out a little bit hesitant, lethargic, and then we turned it on with, you know, maybe about 15, 20 minutes in. We started to kind of play a little bit better, and but still not up to our standard. So that's kind of the message at halftime, to come out with more energy and keep moving the ball. I thought we were dribbling too much. We just had to let it go and move the ball and trust each other instead of trying to do it ourselves. And for the most part, I thought the second half, they did what we asked them to do. And I was happy with the second half. We won the second half, but it would have been nice to finish it off and win the game. But 5-1-0, credit to 5-1-0. They're a good group. They're coached well. Tactically, technically, they're very good. So it was a good game overall, I thought.
What did you think about the way your team was able to create so many set pieces and corner kicks in the second half? What was working for your offense?
Yeah, I think it was just a result of being really aggressive and coming out with more energy and kind of getting after it and going after them 1v1. But it would have been, you know, I know we capitalized on one set piece, but we had a lot that our service just wasn't good enough. I think we just got to train that a little bit more.
defensively, how did you feel like your back line did organization-wise, communication-wise? You said before the game that's a big focus for this group.
Yeah, I thought there was a couple breakdowns, but nothing too major. I thought they kind of held their shape and pushed the line up and dropped when they needed to do that. So I was happy with that. You know, they had a set-piece goal, so they didn't have a goal during a run of play. I thought for the most part we were pretty organized back there.
Moving forward, what is the mentality of this group heading into league play? You mentioned you want them to be chasing, even though you're still going to hold on to the top spot with a draw today. How do you want the team to attack the next game?
Aggressively. You know, I want them to get after it every game, and, you know, we put ourselves in good position to chase that championship. So they're hungry. You know, I told them that they gotta stay hungry and get after it, and it's a good group. They really like each other. They're having a lot of fun right now playing with each other, so I got no doubt they're going to get after it.
Awesome. Head coach Gabe Sosedo, thank you so much. We'll be right back here at Skyline College, a 1-1 draw between the Oakland 5-1-10 Roots and your SF Glens. We'll be right back.
Guys, we are missing pauses.
You mean passes?
No. Pauses. The secret to winning is to pause.
Time out!
I'm taking a step back.
What's the reason?
Sometimes you gotta stop to be, you know, an actual human.
Take a minute to celebrate, right?
Or 20.
Pause is power.
Welcome back to the Avid Sports Medicine post-game show here on KRON On. Full-time between the San Francisco Glens and Oakland Roots Project 5-1-0-1-1. Let's take a look at the highlights and recap this one for you. The opening goal in this one, the own goal by Hugo Dutour, pressured by Josh Redfield, backed into the goal. Maybe appeals for a foul there as Redfield came flying in. No call given, and the goal stands. There were only a few moments during the run of play, and one of them big ones was this one. The Estrada effort saved by Timothy Cyrell. A big bear-like save, pawing it away. That might have been one of the best for the Glens. This, a much harder opportunity, but Mahi's curling effort that nearly equalized early on. Chrétien, who forced an incredible diving save of Timothy Cyrell. And then this glancing ball from Bracken Serra didn't find a home. Mahi, though, would be at it later again, that effort just wide. And then you have the goal, the equalizer from Shayan Charalaghi. There's something about these TV games, 2 for 2 so far. The goal scoring center back in this one. His goal against Marin, unable to spark a second, but in this one, his equalizer stands. If we take a look at the full time stats and see the rundown of everything that happens, you'll see just the number of set pieces that Glens had. I think that number might be a bit low. That number might be closer to 10 or 11 in the corner kicks. And the number of total set pieces and free kicks the Glens had left them wanting more. You heard it in that post-game interview at full time. They had the better run in possession. It seemed like both teams had a bit more confidence with the wind at their backs. It affected their press, but neither one able to really set themselves apart from the other one. Joining me now, once again, is Kylen. Kylen, last final words. We look at these stats. What do you make of it before the Glens look to move on to their next match?
First, the Glens need to come out from kickoff and be more aggressive and more organized. They looked a little bit disjointed early on in this game. They were able to gain a rhythm as the game went on. They did a great job of bouncing back in the second half, really taking it to Project 510, moving off the ball, playing with each other, playing more connected. They had a better run of possession in the second half. And then what stood out to me is the way they created set pieces and corner kicks. They did an excellent job of getting to the end line, looking to get balls across. And if they didn't, they got a deflection, which turned into a corner kick. The only thing you'd like to see them improve upon is getting on the end of some of those corner kicks. Head coach Gabe Sosedo just said you would have liked to knock in a second one when you create so many set pieces and opportunities like the Glens did.
And I guess on the bright side, the stout defense holds up and only conceded 6 goals into this one, conceded a 7th in 7th game, which 1 goal game is excellent, even if that 1 goal is forced. There will be one more match here on KRONon that will be July 10th against Central Valley Fuego 2. 1 p.m. the kickoff at Skyline College here for this one. Again, thank you so much for joining us here on KRON On. 1-1, your full-time score at Skyline College between the San Francisco Glens and Oakland Roots Project 510.